Good morning. I'm Cathy Ann Bencivengo, District Judge from the Southern District of California. It's a real honor this morning to be asked to help open the program and to introduce two outstanding legal scholars who will be talking about Supreme Court review with us. Gentlemen, if you'd come on up. I won't waste any more of their precious time. I know they have a tremendous amount of interesting information to cover, and so For our enjoyment and education, I welcome our very special and admired Judge Jay Bybee and the incomparable Dean Erwin Chemerinsky.
Thank you, Judge Bencivengo, and thank you for inviting us. It's really a pleasure to do this. And we're very honored. I'm especially delighted to be joined by Dean Chemerinsky. It's very humbling to be with the dean. I don't know what the right analogy is. In some ways, I feel like the accordion player in a polka band sharing the stage with Mick Jagger at the Lollapalooza. or maybe I'm the guy on the back of a bicycle built for two with his feet up on the handlebars. One way or the other, I think the dean is going to do most of the work today. So I'm going to start with some statistics, and I'm going to tell you that between the dean and me, we know everything there is to know about the last Supreme Court term. So I'm going to talk for about 10 minutes, and then the dean is going to take the rest of the time. I want to warn you before we start the statistics that you know the old stories about the use of statistics. But I want to warn you about them when we do this. All we're looking at a very, very small sample size. We're looking at about 72, 73, maybe to 75 cases per term. That number has come down over the last 30 years. In the 1980s, the number was still at around 150. We've been down at around 80, I think maybe 10 years ago, and the number seems to be decreasing. So we're looking at a very small sample size when we start. So we're working with small numbers here, and we're just looking at a snapshot. So let's start with this one. This is the one we always start with, which is just the number of majority opinions written by each member of the court. We're looking to see whether it's level. This is the canary in the coal mine. All we're trying to figure out is whether there's an outlier here. Is there somebody who is not getting majority opinions for one of probably two reasons? One, because somebody is not well, or two, because somebody is such an outlier that they can't get the number of opinions. The canary in the coal mine is fine. This is a level court. Chief Justice, or whoever is assigning the opinions, generally the Chief Justice, if he's in the majority, is very concerned about making sure that every member of the court has an assignment, and every member of the court does have an assignment. Let's take a look at the concurring opinions. We're going to start seeing some divergence here. The biggest one that you're going to see, of course, is Justice Thomas. This is sort of our chatty index. Who's talking on the court and who's talking a lot? Well, it is Justice Thomas, and this has been this way for some time. If you look at the bottom four, which would be Roberts, Ginsburg, Alito, and Kagan, between the four of them, they wrote eight concurring opinions. Justice Thomas wrote 16 concurring opinions. Let's take a look at the dissenting opinions. This appears a little more level, although we have a number of folks in the middle. Our big dissenter on the court this last term was Justice Sotomayor, followed by Justice Thomas, which may help explain sort of the poll ends of the court. Justice Kennedy only wrote two dissenting opinions. Justice Kagan only wrote one. So let me tell you something about who may be at the center of the court. We're gonna come back to Justice Gorsuch in a minute, but he's sort of right there with six opinions, pretty comparable to a number of other justices. Combining the slides, this will give us our total opinion authorship, showing concurring, majority, and dissenting opinions. And we go one more, this will give us total opinions. Now, this is something of sort of a clerk misery index. This will tell you, If you are clerking for Justice Thomas and are one of his four clerks, you're going to write between 7 and 8 opinions in the course of the year. If you're clerking for Justice Kagan, you're going to work on 2. That's very, very interesting, just from a clerk perspective, as to what kind of exposure you're going to get on the court. Again, Justice Sotomayor is number two on this list. Justice Breyer is third. We're going to give you the same statistic, but this time these are opinions of at least 5 pages. So it's going to lower the number just a little bit. You're going to see you'll see a gap there. Justice Thomas turns out to be not as much of an outlier on total opinions if you look at the opinions that he wrote that were at least 5 pages. If he wrote at least 5 pages, he's right about where Justice Sotomayor is. So a number of those, it'll tell you Justice Thomas's opinions. He's a little bit idiosyncratic. Sometimes he's simply saying, see my prior dissent, I still disagree with this principle, and leaving it at that. All right, let's go to the vote. Let's go to the vote split. I've listed over on the right side of this slide are the names of the cases. That's what Dean Chemerinsky is going to tell you about in just a minute. But let's look at the number of cases in which that were decided unanimously or nearly unanimously. So if we go just to the 9080 cases, 28 of I think it's 72 or 73, depending on how you count the number of cases this term, 28 were decided nearly unanimously. If we add in the 8-1 decisions, that gives you 34 cases. That's just a little bit less than half. And certainly more than half if you go to a supermajority and just go down to a 7-2 decision. So 45 of the, whatever it is, 72, 73 cases this term were decided by supermajorities. Now, if you look at the bottom of the list, the 5-4s and 5-3s, there are 20 cases there. So that's a little less than a fourth, somewhere between a third and a fourth of the cases were closely divided cases. Next slide is the same slide, just has the listing of the other cases. So here's another way of looking at that. These are the votes by percentage, so that you can see it yourself. Again, 35% of the cases decided unanimously. 39% if you go to 8-0. 47% if you go to 8-1. So, all right, now we're going to start looking at individual justices. The next slide will tell you how frequently each justice voted in the majority. So, we just learned that most of the cases decided by the Supreme Court, or at least a large percentage of them, were decided unanimously. So we would expect justices to be in the majority of the opinions quite frequently. So now we're looking at the actual numbers. Now this includes summary reversals. And this tells us that the Chief Justice and Justice Kennedy are the two justices who vote most frequently in the majority. That should tell you something about where the center of the court is. Look who's number three on the list. It's Justice Gorsuch. And he's not too far behind. Then there's a jump to Justice Thomas and then Justice Alito. So if you're looking at the top five justices in the majority, this is a preview of something coming up. The top five justices always voting with the majority are the conservatives. The bottom of that list is Justice Alito, which may tell you that suggests that Justice Alito may be the most conservative of the conservative justices. Okay, looking at the bottom of the list, Kagan, Ginsburg, Breyer, Sotomayor at 68%. All right, the next slide, same statistics, except I've removed the summary reversals. Now this is a little more helpful. So the numbers are going to drop here because we've taken off the summary reversals. Again, the order doesn't change at all. It is still Roberts and Kennedy right at the top. A little bit bigger jump to Gorsuch, Thomas, and Alito. And look down at Sotomayor. She is the only justice who joined less than 50% of the majority opinions, excluding the summary reversals. Again, should tell you something about who's at the polls of the court. Okay, the next two slides, I just want to tell you, the next two slides are shocking. So if your constitution is weak, you may wish to avert your eyes. So this is majority alignment in divided cases. So let's start with at the top. We have with Roberts, Kennedy, Thomas, Alito, and Gorsuch. Those are the five conservative justices. 14 cases in divided cases were decided with that five-member alignment. If you look at the next four alignments, you'll see that they're a bit of a mixed bag. They're sort of those odd alignments that are difficult to predict. Notice what is not on the list. There is not a single case in the last term in which Kennedy joined the four liberals on the court. Zero. Let me show you this in history. So here's my next slide. Again, for the faint of heart, you may wish to avert your eyes. This is over the last five terms, showing the 5-4 alignments with Kennedy. That's the one on the left. Showing the five-member alignment with Kennedy joining the liberals. That's on the right. So 2017 term, 14-0. If we go back to 2016, that was 2-4. That is, Kennedy joined more frequently with the liberals on 5-4 divided decisions in 2016 than he did with the conservatives. 2015, it's 1-3 again, 5-8, 2014. So there you had 13 cases decided by 5-4 decisions, and Kennedy split with the liberals 8 times to 3 times. But in 2017, it's 14-0. I'm sure that Erwin is going to have some comments on that. All right, we're going to run here to the frequency and the majority over time. These are the four justices on the left. All we're doing is tracking their agreement with the majority over time. We're going to have a peak at OT 2014. That's the 2014-2015 term. And then we've got a trough. All of a sudden, things are on a bit of a downward slide. Here's the same slide, but with the five justices on the right. I've included Justice Kennedy in the following slide. And again, it shows that trough in 2014-2015. That's the year of Obergefell. So Justice Kennedy in that year clearly went with the left, and that shows the trough. If you look at the polls, if you look at the end of the chart, so look at 2008 compared with 2017, the numbers haven't changed very much. We just have a trough at least in that one year. So it looks like October term 2014 was a little bit atypical as we look at it over time. All right, the next one. These are justices. This is who's agreeing with whom. So on the left, these are the ones who most frequently agree with each other, and that would be Justices Ginsburg and Sotomayor, followed by Justices Thomas and Alito. We have very close alignment between Breyer and Kagan, no surprise there. Sotomayor and Kagan, and Roberts and Kennedy. Notice who's not on that list. Justice Gorsuch. So he's not among those he's not agreeing with anybody in particular on the court at a high enough rate, okay? Now, if you look over on the right side, which is the low agreement, these are who's disagreeing most frequently with whom. Alito and Sotomayor, again, probably representing the polls of the court. Your most conservative, your most liberal justice, agree with each other less than 50% of the time. Then it's Thomas Sotomayor, Ginsburg Alito, Breyer Alito, Thomas Ginsburg. Again, look whose name is missing. Justice Kennedy is not on that list. Justice Roberts is not on that list. Justice Gorsuch is not on that list at all. All right, these are just fun facts. This is who's talking at oral argument. Justice Sotomayor turns out to come out of the blocks the fastest and to ask more questions than anybody else. Justice Thomas down at the bottom, no surprises there. Look at Justice Kennedy. I've always considered Justice Kennedy to be a fairly active questioner, but I'd never really counted the number of questions. Turns out he's actually not all that active in oral argument, or it just means that everybody else is elbowed him out of the way. All right, well, we always want to know what the circuit scorecard is, so how did we do this year? Ready, hold your breath, here we go. Okay, there's the circuit scorecard. The Ninth Circuit was reversed in 86% of the cases. That's up just a little bit. 79% is the overall reversal rate. We're just barely above that. Again, don't put too much stock in that. That means maybe one case above the mean. If you're looking at the wall of shame, though, that is the First, Third, and Sixth Circuits that were reversed in 100% of the cases they had. And honorable mention goes to the Fourth Circuit, which did not have a single case affirmed by the Supreme Court in this last term. Somebody really ought to do something about that, and I'm sure that if Jim Duff's here, that he will see that somebody looks into this. All right, here's a quick report on Justice Gorsuch's full term. He writes 7 majority opinions. He dissents in 6 cases. He writes 4 concurrences. Here's how he played out with the other justices. So he agrees with his former boss, Justice Kennedy, in 86% of the cases, and then Justice Roberts, Alito, Thomas. Significant drop-off between Thomas and Kagan, all the way down to, again, no surprises here, Justice Sotomayor. Again, if we look at divided cases, this is probably a little bit better measure. He has a 95% agreement rate with both Thomas and Alito, just a little bit lower with Justice Kennedy, and then a drop to Justice Roberts. Big drops there from there to Ginsburg, Kagan, Breyer, and Sotomayor, only 5% of the time in divided cases. All right, that's the Supreme Court by the numbers, and it's now my pleasure to turn the mic over to the incomparable Erwin Chemerinsky.
Thank you. Since I'm vertically challenged, I think I'll stand up. Thank you for the sweet words and the warm introduction. It's really wonderful to be with you. Truly an honor and a pleasure. It's an amazing time in the United States Supreme Court. I thought I'd make 3 observations about the current likely future court, and then look at the major decisions in 6 areas. My first observation is that I think last term is the beginning of a new era on the Supreme Court, an era without a swing justice. Last term, the Supreme Court decided 59 cases with signed opinions after briefing and oral argument. That's the fewest number since 1864. The conservative position prevailed in almost all of those cases. Eras on the Supreme Court last a long time. There was one era from the 1890s to 1936 where there was a conservative court that frequently was striking down progressive legislation, especially to protect employees and consumers. Over 200 federal, state, and local laws were invalidated during this time. Another era was from 1937 to 1969. There's always a majority of the justices appointed by Democratic presidents. The court became progressively more liberal, especially in the 1960s, under the direction of Chief Justice Earl Warren. The next era of the court began in 1969, with Richard Nixon picking 2 justices of the court, and then 2 more in 1971. From 1969 through now, there have always been at least 5, and sometimes as many as 8 justices appointed by Republican presidents. But all through this era, from 1969 through a term ago, October term 2016, there was always a swing justice, a Lewis Powell, a Sandra Day O'Connor, an Anthony Kennedy, a justice who might join with the liberal justices, particularly in some of the most controversial high-profile areas. But last term, there was no swing justice. I think of the statistics that Judge Bybee just presented, the most important, as the slides that showed, there were 19 5-4 decisions. In 14 of them, Justice Kennedy joined with Chief Justice Roberts and Justice Thomas, Alito, and Gorsuch. In 0 did Justice Kennedy join with Justice Ginsburg, Breyer, Souter, and Kagan. The term before, when the court was split 5-4 or 5-3, Justice Kennedy was the liberals 57% of the time. I think with Justice Kennedy being replaced, most likely by Judge Brett Kavanaugh, we'll be in an era where there's no swing justice for the foreseeable future. And this is an era likely to last for some time. If you look at the ages of the conservative justices, Clarence Thomas is 70, Samuel Alito is 68, John Roberts is 63, Neil Gorsuch is 50, Brett Kavanaugh is 53. So maybe the bottom line as you look at the Supreme Court is that if you are conservative, this is a time to be jubilant. And if you're liberal, maybe the best thing you can hope for is that the Supreme Court will continue to decide fewer and fewer cases each year. Second observation, Judge Brett Kavanaugh. What will it mean to replace Anthony Kennedy with Brett Kavanaugh, assuming he's confirmed? One of the statistics important about Anthony Kennedy is that over his 30 years on the Supreme Court, when the justices were divided 5-4, Kennedy was with the conservatives about 75% of the time. I think in those cases, Judge Kavanaugh is likely to vote the same way as Justice Kennedy. So again, if you think of high-profile areas like campaign finance or the Second Amendment, I expect that Judge Kavanaugh, like Justice Kennedy, would be with the conservative four justices. But I can identify five areas where Anthony Kennedy is often with the liberals. Replacing him can make an enormous difference in the law. One is abortion rights. In Planned Parenthood versus Casey in 1992, Anthony Kennedy cast the fifth vote to reaffirm Roe versus Wade. 2 years ago, in Whole Woman's Health versus Hellerstedt, Justice Kennedy cast the fifth vote to strike down a Texas law restricting access to abortion. Second, affirmative action. 2 years ago, in Fisher versus University of Texas, Austin, Justice Kennedy wrote the opinion holding an affirmative action program and saying that college universities should have great discretion in creating diversity in the classroom and remedying past discrimination. Third area, gay and lesbian rights. In every Supreme Court decision expanding rights for gays and lesbians, the majority opinion was written by Anthony Kennedy. Fourth, the exclusionary rule. In 2006, in Hudson versus Michigan, Justice Scalia wrote an opinion joined by three justices urging the overruling of the exclusionary rule as a remedy for police violations of the Fourth Amendment. Justice Kennedy, the fifth vote for the result, said, "The continued operation of the exclusionary rule is not in doubt." But might it be with Justice Kennedy leaving the bench? And fifth, limits on the death penalty. For example, in Roper versus Simmons in 2005, Justice Kennedy wrote the opinion saying, "The death penalty for crimes committed by juveniles is cruel and unusual punishment." In 2008, in Kennedy versus Louisiana, Justice Kennedy wrote the majority opinion saying that it's cruel and unusual punishment to use the death penalty for the crime of child rape. Will Justice Kennedy's replacement lead the court more likely to uphold death sentences? Third and final observation, what about the longer-term future of the court? Did you know that since 1960, 78 years old is the average age when Supreme Court justices left the bench? When the court resumes on the first Monday in October, there'll be two justices over that age. Ruth Bader Ginsburg turned 85 on March 15th. Stephen Breyer will turn 80 on August 15th. Now, I have no doubt that Justice Ginsburg and Breyer will try to remain on the court to the end of the Trump presidency if their health allows them to do so. I've heard many remark that Justice Ginsburg looks very frail on the bench. I first met her in 1986 when she was a judge on the DC Circuit. She looked really frail then, too. And I've got to believe that Justice Ginsburg and Breyer have left instructions with their clerks that if anything happens to them, just keep them on the bench and keep voting. But of course, given their ages, it's quite possible that President Trump will get other picks for the Supreme Court to further solidify a staunch conservative majority. So that's the context for looking at the specific decisions of October term 2017. As I said, I've divided this into six major areas. The first are the criminal procedure and criminal law cases of the term. This is the one area where the liberal justices were consistently in the majority. I subdivided this into two parts. The first concerns the Fourth Amendment. The initial case here is Byrd versus United States. Latasha Reed and her boyfriend, Terrence Byrd, went to rent a car. Reed rented it in her name, but gave the keys to her boyfriend, Terrence Byrd. Byrd was driving in Pennsylvania and got stopped by a police officer. He wanted to give Byrd a warning for spending too much time driving in the left lane. You might wonder what made the officer suspicious with regard to Byrd. He pointed to three things. He said Byrd's hands were in the steering wheel in the 10 and 2 position. Isn't that what we all learned in driver's ed we're supposed to do? He said Byrd was leaning back in the seat, and he said the officer could tell from a barcode on the window it was a rental car. The officer asked to see the license and registration. The officer saw that it was a rental car, and he believed that that then meant that Byrd had no expectation of privacy. The officer asked Byrd to open the trunk. A large amount of heroin was found there. Byrd brought a suppression motion. The federal district court denied the suppression motion, saying since it was a rental car, there's no reasonable expectation of privacy. The Third Circuit affirmed. The Supreme Court unanimously reversed in an opinion by Justice Kennedy. Justice Kennedy said that even though Byrd was not an authorized driver on the rental agreement, he was in lawful possession of the vehicle. He said this gives Byrd a reasonable expectation of privacy. The primary argument made by the United States government to the Supreme Court was that the rental agreement itself had language that no one other than the authorized driver could operate the vehicle without permission of the company. But Justice Kennedy said, rental agreements are long. They've got a lot of small print. They shouldn't determine the reasonable expectation of privacy. The key seems to be, is the driver in lawful possession of the vehicle? If it was a stolen car, it would be different. If lies were told in obtaining the rental car, it'd be different. But otherwise, the driver has an expectation of privacy that allows her to assert Fourth Amendment rights. The second of the Fourth Amendment cases, Carpenter versus the United States, is by far the most important of all the criminal cases. Timothy Carpenter was a suspect in a series of armed robberies. Perhaps ironically, given the issues in the case, they were armed robberies of Radio Shacks. I realize when I teach this case in criminal procedure in the fall, I'm going to have to explain to my students what a Radio Shack used to be. But I also know when I teach Cats versus the United States, I'm going to need to explain to them what a phone booth used to be. Police officers went to Carpenter's cellular company, and under the Stored Communications Act, got an order to obtain his cellular location information. Every time any of us uses a cell phone, it communicates with a cell tower. Doesn't matter if we're texting or emailing or checking the web. In fact, if our phone is on, even if we're not using, it communicates with the cellular tower. As we move, our phone transfers from one cellular tower to another. So you can determine somebody's location and somebody's movements through this cellular location information. The police obtained Carpenter's cellular records for a period of 127 days. He brought a suppression motion. The federal district court denied the suppression motion, pointing to the third party doctrine. The third party doctrine says that if a person has voluntarily turned information over to a third party, there's no reasonable expectation of privacy. It comes from a Supreme Court case in the mid-1970s, United States versus Miller, that says we have no reasonable expectation of privacy as to bank records because the bank has the information. In Smith versus Maryland, a few years later, the court said, we have no reasonable expectation of privacy in the phone numbers we call or receive calls from because the phone company has the information. The district court denied the suppression motion. Carpenter was convicted. He was sentenced to 119 years in prison. The Sixth Circuit affirmed. But the United States Supreme Court reversed in a 5-4 decision. Chief Justice Roberts wrote the opinion for the court, joined by Justice Ginsburg, Breyer, Sotomayor, and Kagan. Each of the four dissenting justices, Kennedy, Thomas, Alito, and Gorsuch, wrote a separate dissent. Chief Justice Roberts began by talking about the privacy interest we have with regard to our cell phones and cellular location information. He said a lot of personal information can be learned about somebody through cellular location information. We can know what doctors the individual is visiting, what people the person is seeing, where the person is going to worship. The court said, therefore, that police need to get a warrant in order to access cellular location information. Now, the court said here it was dealing just with stored information. Chief Justice Roberts said the court wasn't dealing with whether the police can access real-time cellular location information without a warrant. The court said it wasn't reconsidering the third-party doctrine more generally. The court said it wasn't dealing with a foreign policy or a national security situation. Nonetheless, I think this case is going to be enormously important. In 2016, AT&T and Verizon, just two cellular companies, 125,000 times provided cellular location information to the police. These will now require a warrant. Also, for the judges in the room, the issue is going to come before you. How does this apply to pending cases or cases that are on appeal? I think the answer is that the exclusionary rule likely will not require this information to be kept out or that convictions be reconsidered. Because at the time that the information was accessed, the police the magistrate judges were acting in good faith. The Supreme Court said the exclusion rule applies only if there's an intentional or reckless violation of the Fourth Amendment. In fact, just a little over a week ago, the United States Court of Appeals for the Fourth Circuit in United States versus Chavez said that Carpenter should not apply to those cases precisely for the reason I said, the police, the magistrate judges were acting in good faith. The third and final Fourth Amendment case that I mentioned is Collins versus Virginia. A police officer was chasing a motorcycle. It was a traffic violation. The motorcycle got away. But the officer noted the distinctive characteristics of the motorcycle, including unusual painting and markings, and got part of the license plate number. A couple weeks later, another police officer was chasing a motorcycle for speeding, and it got away. The officer talked and realized they were actually chasing the same motorcycle. They did some research, especially on Facebook, and they were able to find where the motorcycle was likely located. They also discovered the internet that the motorcycle was stolen. They went to the address where they thought the motorcycle would be found, and they noticed on the driveway, on the property of the house, there appeared to be a motorcycle covered by a tarp. The officers left the public street, they went onto the private property, they lifted the tarp, and it was clear that was the motorcycle they were looking for. They then were able to talk to the driver. He admitted he bought it without a title. He was arrested for having possession of stolen merchandise. He brought a suppression motion. The Virginia courts denied it. The Virginia Supreme Court ruled against him. The Virginia Supreme Court relied on the automobile exception to the Fourth Amendment. But the Supreme Court reversed in a 6-3 decision. Justice Sotomayor wrote the opinion for the court. Justice Alito wrote for the dissent. Justice Sotomayor said that the underlying rationale of the automobile exception to the Fourth Amendment is that a motor vehicle can be moved. She said that doesn't apply when the motor vehicle is parked. In those circumstances, police can get a warrant. She stressed that the motorcycle was parked in the curtilage, the private property around the house. She said the Fourth Amendment has its most important application when it comes to the privacy of the home. Justice Thomas wrote a concurring opinion that could have implications for the future. In it, he argued that Matt versus Ohio, the 1961 decision that applied the exclusionary rule to state and local governments, was wrongly decided and urged the court to reconsider it. Justice Alito, in his dissenting opinion, said, there's no reason to draw a bright line distinction between the driveway in front of the house and the driveway on private property, and he would have allowed the evidence to come in. I want to talk about one other criminal law case, and it's one that I think also has implications with regard to civil litigation. The case is McCoy versus Louisiana. Robert McCoy was being tried for capital murder in Louisiana State Trial Court. He was represented by a public defender. He had a falling out with his lawyer, and his family hired a private counsel. The private lawyer urged McCoy to admit that he had done the killings, but to contest whether he had the mens rea for first-degree murder. McCoy strongly disagreed. He did not want to admit that he had committed the killings. Nonetheless, at trial, McCoy's lawyer began an opening statement by saying that McCoy had committed the killings. McCoy was convicted of first-degree murder. He was sentenced to death. His argument was that for the lawyer to admit the killings violated the Sixth Amendment right to counsel. The Supreme Court, in a 6-3 decision, agreed with McCoy. Justice Ginsburg wrote the opinion for the court. Justice Alito wrote for the dissent. Justice Ginsburg said, there's a whole range of issues where counsel gets to make the choice. Counsel gets to decide what evidence to introduce. Counsel gets to decide what objections to make. But Justice Ginsburg said, it's elemental to the law of professional responsibility that the client gets to decide the objectives of the representation. Here, McCoy had decided, above all, that he didn't want to admit to the killings. Now, the primary argument of the state of Louisiana was that under the standard of ineffective assistance of counsel, there has to be proof of prejudice. And Louisiana said, given the evidence, there was no prejudice. McCoy would have been convicted and sentenced to death anyway. The Supreme Court rejected that argument. Justice Ginsburg said, this is structural error. When there's structural error, harmless error analysis doesn't apply. Prejudice doesn't have to be proven. I think this is an important reaffirmation of a core aspect of professional responsibility. It applies in civil as well as criminal cases. It's ultimately for the client to decide the ultimate objectives of the representation. The second major area I want to talk about concerns the First Amendment, and there are three cases here. The first is Masterpiece Cake Shop versus Colorado Civil Rights Commission. A gay couple in Colorado went to Massachusetts to get married. This was a time when same-sex marriage was allowed in Massachusetts, but not yet in Colorado. They came back home to Colorado, and they wanted to have a party to celebrate their wedding with family and friends. They went to a local bakery, Masterpiece Cake Shop. They asked the proprietor, Jack Phillips, to design and bake a cake for them. Phillips refused. He said that same-sex weddings violated his religious beliefs. He said he'd be complicit in something against his religion if he designed and baked a cake. Colorado, like California, like many states, has a public accommodations law that says that business establishments cannot discriminate based on race, sex, religion, or sexual orientation. The couple filed a complaint with the Colorado Civil Rights Commission. There were lengthy administrative proceedings. There was an investigator, an administrative law judge, and ultimately a decision by the Civil Rights Commission. It ruled in favor of the couple and against Masterpiece Cake Shop. The Colorado Court of Appeals affirmed. The Colorado Supreme Court denied review. The Supreme Court, in a 7-2 decision, reversed. Justice Kennedy wrote the opinion for the court. Justice Ginsburg and Sotomayor dissented. There were important, profoundly significant questions raised in this case. Does it violate free exercise of religion to hold a business proprietor liable if he or she won't provide service based on his or religious beliefs? Is it impermissible compelled speech to force somebody to provide services against his or her wishes? The Supreme Court did not decide those issues. Instead, Justice Kennedy, writing for the majority, said that the Colorado Civil Rights Commission had expressed undue animus to religion. The Supreme Court said the government violates the Constitution if it acts with hostility to religion. I think it's important to focus on the evidence here that the court found to be sufficient for a conclusion of hostility to religion. Justice Kennedy pointed to three pieces of evidence. First, at an initial hearing, a member of the Colorado Civil Rights Commission said that anyone who wants to do business in Colorado has to serve all customers regardless of the owner's religious beliefs. Hard to really see that as evidence of religious animus. This is a statement of the law of Colorado. At a second hearing, another member of the commission said that some terrible things have been done in world history in the name of religion, like slavery and the Holocaust, and it's detestable for someone to harm another in the name of religion. It's sad, but it's true that a lot of terrible things have been done in the name of religion. And finally, the court said there were some other cases where bakers were not held liable for refusal to bake cakes with particular messages. But as Justice Kagan pointed out in a concurring opinion, in none of those instances did bakers refuse to bake cakes on the basis of race or sex or religion or sexual orientation, the grounds forbidden by the Colorado statute. The Supreme Court said since it found undue animus on the basis of religion, it was going to reverse the case and send it back to the Colorado courts. So the key profound questions I mentioned are left open. Justice Thomas wrote a concurring opinion joined by Justice Gorsuch, in which he said the court should have accepted the free speech argument, that forcing the baker to design and bake a cake would be impermissible compelled speech. If ever the court accepts this argument with a majority of the justices, it will have profound implications. If baking a cake is speech, then isn't engraving wedding invitations, or providing floral arrangements, or applying makeup, or taking photographs at a wedding speech? In fact, if baking a cake is speech, then isn't cooking food speech? Couldn't a restaurant choose to not serve customers, even on the basis of race, by saying to force it to do so be impermissible compelled speech? At the oral argument, Justice Stephen Breyer said, if the court accepted the speech argument, it would create an exception to every civil rights law adopted since, quote, day 2, I have no idea why he picked day two for that. But his point is, accepting this would create an enormous exception to civil rights laws. The issue is sure to come before the Supreme Court. And ultimately, if you think about it, didn't the Supreme Court leave open the question of whether the Colorado Court of Appeals was right in concluding that bakers can't be choosers? Sorry. Oh, well. The second case that I've listed is National Institute of Family and Life Advocates versus Becerra. A couple of years ago, Colorado adopted a law called the Reproductive Fact Act. It says that health facilities that provide reproductive care to women in California must post a notice that the state of California will make free and low-cost contraception abortions available for women who economically qualify. Also, unlicensed facilities must post notices that they're not licensed to provide health care in California. The legislative history said that this was motivated by the fact there are over 200 so-called pregnancy crisis counseling centers in the state, that they're affiliated with religion, they often fail to inform women of their rights, and sometimes write inaccurate information about abortions and its health consequences. Some of these facilities brought a challenge to the California law. The Ninth Circuit, an opinion by Judge Dorothy Nelson, affirmed denial of preliminary injunction. The Ninth Circuit said that the law was likely constitutional. The Ninth Circuit stressed that this is professional speech and that the government often requires disclosures in the context of professional speech. Informed disclosures are required in medicine, law, and many other areas. The Ninth Circuit also pointed to the fact that no one in these facilities was required to say anything. It was just posting a notice on the wall to give women accurate information about their rights and about the nature of the facilities. The Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, reversed. Justice Clarence Thomas wrote the opinion for the court, joined by the 4 conservative justices. Justice Breyer wrote the dissent, joined by the 3 more liberal justices. Justice Thomas began his majority opinion by saying that the California law was a content-based restriction on speech. That is, it prescribed the content of the disclosures required. He said content-based restrictions on speech must meet strict scrutiny. The court then found both parts of the California law to fail strict scrutiny. As to the part that required that these facilities notify women of the availability of free and low-cost contraception and abortion, so this was compelled speech. In addition, there's other ways that the state could inform women of this information. With regard to the requirement that unlicensed facilities post that, he said that there's no showing of a problem in California. The court said such compelled speech violates the First Amendment. Justice Breyer made 2 primary points in dissent. First, he said the Supreme Court previously upheld state laws that required that abortion providers supply information to women that was meant to discourage abortions. He pointed to the Supreme Court's decision in Planned Parenthood versus Casey that required that doctors provide women information about the nature of the fetus at that stage of pregnancy, tell them of the availability of adoption providers. He said the court here has a content-based restriction itself, allowing the government to require speech to discourage abortion, but not to provide women information about the right to abortion. And second, he said, this is going to open the door to challenges to all sorts of laws that require disclosure. He said, any law that requires disclosure is by definition a content-based requirement with regard to speech. So the majority has rejected any lesser level of scrutiny when it comes to professional speech. And he then gave a laundry list of examples of laws that require disclosures. Laws that require that restaurants disclose calorie counts. Laws that require that employers post notice to employees about their rights. Laws that require that bars notify women about the health consequences of consuming alcohol during pregnancy. He said all of these laws are now vulnerable to challenge. Now, Justice Thomas in the majority opinion said most of those laws are different because they involve non-controversial information. But of course, Justice Breyer in dissent said, what's controversial is very much in the eyes of the beholder. So I think it is going to open the door to many more challenges. The final speech case that I listed is Janus versus American Federation. In 1977, in Abood versus Detroit Board of Education, the Supreme Court reaffirmed that no one can be forced to join a public employees union. But the court said that non-union members can be required to pay the share of the union dues that go to support the collective bargaining activities of the union. The court said non-union members benefit from collective bargaining in terms of their wages, their hours, their working conditions. The court said they shouldn't be able to be free riders. But the court said non-union members cannot be forced to pay the share of the dues that go to support the political activities of the union. That would be impermissible compelled speech. Twice in the last decade, in Knox versus SEIU and in Harris versus Quinn, the five conservative justices on the court sharply criticized Abood. They clearly were inviting a case that would give it the chance to reconsider Abood. That case came to the Supreme Court 2 years ago in Friedrichs versus California Teachers Association, but before the court could decide, Justice Scalia passed away, and the court announced it was affirming the Ninth Circuit in Abood by an evenly divided court. Janus versus American Federation involves a public employee in Illinois who objected to having to pay the so-called fair share, the part of the union dues that go to support collective bargaining. He asked the Seventh Circuit to overrule the Supreme Court decision. Then Judge Richard Posner, in a single sentence, said Abood was binding on the court. On Wednesday, June 27th, the Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, overruled Abood. Here, Justice Alito wrote for the court, again joined by the conservative justices. Justice Kagan wrote a vehement dissent, joined by the liberal justices. Justice Alito, writing for the court, said Abood was wrong when it was decided, and it's wrong now. He said compelled speech violates the First Amendment. He said to force non-union members to pay the share of the dues that go to support collective bargaining is impermissible compelled speech. He rejected the arguments that there is a compelling interest in preventing free riders or in protecting labor peace. Justice Kagan, in her dissent, said that since Abood was decided 41 years ago, thousands of public employee contracts are based on it. It affects millions of employees. She said there's no basis for overruling Abood other than, to quote her words, the majority wants to. She accused the majority of weaponizing the First Amendment, using the First Amendment as a basis for challenging laws. And of course, that's common to all three of the free speech cases that I've discussed. I think this is going to lead to an enormous amount of litigation. A couple of weeks ago, in the week following Janus, 10 lawsuits were filed around the country on the behalf of non-union members who had paid the fair share in the past and were now seeking a refund. Also, will this be extended to apply to private employee unions? That's pending in a number of courts across the country. Twice in his majority opinion, Justice Alito said that exclusive representation in bargaining, the core of the National Labor Relations Act, is in tension with freedom of speech. Also, what about other instances where people have to pay money? Bar dues, student activity fees. Might the court reconsider the law in those areas in light of what it's done in Janus? The third area that I want to look at this morning concerns immigration. And I want to talk about two cases. The first, maybe the most important case of the term, is Trump versus Hawaii. Everyone here is familiar with the factual background. On Friday, January 27th, 2017, President Trump issued an executive order that he's referred to as the travel ban. It suspended immigration from 7 designated countries for a period of 90 days. It suspended the refugee program for 120 days. It had an exception for those who are minority religions in these predominantly Muslim countries. And it applied even to those who had green cards and visas. Quickly, federal district courts began to issue preliminary injunctions. Federal district court in Washington State issued a nationwide preliminary injunction, and the Ninth Circuit unanimously affirmed. The Trump administration did not seek Supreme Court review. Instead, President Trump issued a new version of the travel ban, often referred to as Travel Ban 2.0. It applied to 6 of those countries. Iraq was taken off the list. And it suspended immigration for a 90-day period. It suspended the refugee program for a 120-day period. But it did not have the exception for those of minority religions, and it did not apply to those with green cards and visas. Federal District Court in Maryland issued a preliminary injunction. The Fourth Circuit, an unusual en banc decision without a panel ruling, affirmed. Judge Roger Gregory wrote for the court and said that the travel ban was, quote, dripping with animus against Muslims. Federal District Court in Hawaii issued a preliminary injunction. The Ninth Circuit affirmed, primarily on statutory grounds. A year ago, on Monday, June 26, 2017, the Supreme Court granted review in both of these cases, and the court said they should be heard in October. They were put on the argument calendar, but by the time they were to be heard, the 90-day period had already lapsed, and the 120-day period was about to expire. The court took them off the argument calendar and dismissed them as moot. The Trump administration then issued the third version of the travel ban, this time by executive proclamation. It suspended immigration from 8 designated countries. 5 were on the original list, and added to it were North Korea, Venezuela, and Chad. Do you know how many people come to the United States each year from North Korea? I checked, 18. And I have no idea what Chad did to get itself on the list. But it was taken off the list by the time of oral argument. Federal District Court in Hawaii issued a preliminary injunction. The Ninth Circuit, in a per curiam opinion, affirmed. The Ninth Circuit focused on a federal statute. The 1965 Immigration and Nationality Act prohibits discrimination with regard to the issuance of visas on the basis of race, sex, religion, national origin, or country of residence. The Supreme Court granted review in the Ninth Circuit case. Meanwhile, the Federal District Court in Maryland issued a preliminary injunction. The Fourth Circuit affirmed, saying the travel ban was impermissible religious discrimination. The court did not grant cert in that case, but held it on the docket. On Tuesday, June 26th, the Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, reversed the Ninth Circuit. Chief Justice Roberts wrote for the court, joined by the conservative justices. There were 2 dissenting opinions, one by Justice Breyer and one by Justice Sotomayor, joined by Justices Ginsburg and Kagan. There were 2 parts to Chief Justice Roberts' majority opinion. The first was statutory. He said, under a 1952 Immigration and Nationality Act, the president can make decisions as to allow or exclude from the country. He said, this is controlling, and that the ability to, with regard to visas under the 1965 Act and the prohibition of discrimination is subordinate to it. And second, with regard to religious discrimination, Chief Justice Roberts said, the president has broad discretion in the area of immigration. The court said, only rational basis review is to be used when it comes to presidential decisions to immigration. As you know, under rational basis review, government action is upheld if it's rationally related to a legitimate government purpose. Under rational basis review, the government's actual purpose is irrelevant. Under rational basis review, any conceivable purpose is sufficient. So the actual purpose behind the travel ban wouldn't matter. The court said the government has asserted national security, and that's a conceivable, legitimate purpose. Justice Breyer wrote a relatively short dissent saying, there are so many exceptions in the executive order, there's still a basis for challenge that this is unduly arbitrary and that the exceptions may show religious discrimination, so this might be litigated on remand. Justice Sotomayor wrote the stronger dissent. She went on for pages quoting all of Donald Trump's statements as a candidate as president, all the statements from members of administration that there wanted to be a Muslim ban. She said such animus on the basis of religion violates the Constitution. Obviously, the case is enormously important in upholding the travel ban. I think its longer-term significance is going to be the Supreme Court saying that presidential decisions with regard to immigration only have to meet rational basis review, even when there's a constitutional claim, like violation of the Establishment Clause and free exercise clauses of the First Amendment. The other immigration case got much less attention, but will also have real practical significance. It's Sessions versus DiMaia. On June 26, 2015, the Supreme Court in Johnson versus United States declared unconstitutional the residual clause in the Armed Career Criminal Act. The Armed Career Criminal Act, of course, is a federal law that says if a person uses a firearm committing a crime of violence and has three prior convictions for a crime of violence, there's a mandatory minimum sentence of 15 years in prison. Crime of violence is defined in categories. Arson's a category. Burglary is a category. And the last category has always been known as the residual clause. It says another crime where there's a serious risk of physical injury to a person. The Supreme Court, 8-1, said that was unconstitutionally vague. When Johnson came down, I said there's going to be two major issues. One is, does it apply retroactively to those whose sentences were final before June 26, 2015? In the next term in Welch versus the United States, the Supreme Court held that Johnson applied retroactively. The other question is, what about other statutes or sentencing guideline provisions that use the same language as the residual clause? I'm not very good on Westlaw or Lexis, but I immediately went on Westlaw and found over a dozen federal statutes and sentencing guideline provisions that use language just like the residual clause. Well, a year ago in Beckles versus United States, the Supreme Court held that Johnson does not apply to the sentencing guidelines. Justice Thomas wrote for the court and said the sentencing guidelines are advisory, not mandatory. This makes them different from the Armed Career Criminal Act. One thing that I would note, though, the Supreme Court has not yet ruled is whether Johnson would apply to pre-Booker use of the sentencing guidelines, pre-2006 use, when the sentencing guidelines were thought to be mandatory. But the court still had the question about, well, what about other federal statutes that use language like the sentencing guidelines? That's where Sessions versus DiMaia comes in. It involves a provision of the Immigration and Nationality Act that defines an aggravated felony. An aggravated felony is an automatic basis for deportation. An aggravated felony is defined in categories, and the last category is like the residual clause. Another crime where there's a serious risk of physical injury to a person. In November 2015, 5 months after Johnson, the Ninth Circuit, in a 2-1 decision, found this provision to be unconstitutionally vague. The late Judge Stephen Reinhart wrote for the court. Judge Callahan wrote the dissent. The Supreme Court granted review. The case was heard a term ago, an October term, 2016. But at the end of the term, the court announced it was putting it over for re-argument. The conventional wisdom is that the justices were split 4-4. Turns out that here, the conventional wisdom was right. The Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, affirmed the Ninth Circuit. The majority opinion was written by Justice Kagan, joined by Justice Ginsburg, Breyer, Sotomayor, and Gorsuch. Chief Justice Roberts wrote a dissent here. Justice Thomas also wrote a separate dissent, joined by the other two dissenting justices. Justice Kagan said that the definition of an aggravated felony under the Immigration and Nationality Act is essentially the same as the definition of an armed felony under the basis of the Armed Career Criminal Act. She said both statutes use categories. Both have residual clauses that use almost exactly the same language. She said there's no basis for drawing a distinction between immigration, which is civil, and criminal cases, given the consequences of deportation. Chief Justice Roberts, in his dissent, drew distinctions between the two statutes, but also said there's an important difference between civil matters, immigration, and criminal statutes. Justice Thomas, in his dissent, said, from an originalist perspective, laws should never be declared unconstitutional under due process on vagueness grounds. He said the void for vagueness doctrine can't be reconciled with an originalist view of due process. Justice Gorsuch wrote a concurring opinion to respond to Justice Thomas and said that vagueness can be justified as a doctrine from an originalist perspective. Obviously, this case is going to matter in the immigration context, but I also think it sends a clear message that other laws that use language like the residual clause are unconstitutionally vague. The fourth area that I want to look at concerns voting. And the key case here is Gill versus Whitford. It was one of the most high-profile cases of the term. It had the potential to have an enormous effect with regard to our political system. but it didn't turn out that way. It involves partisan gerrymandering. Partisan gerrymandering, of course, is nothing new. It takes its name from a governor early in American history, Elbridge Gerry, who drew election districts to maximize, say, seats for his political party. Partisan gerrymandering, of course, is where a Republican-controlled state legislature draws election districts to maximize seats for Republicans, or a Democratic-controlled city council draws election districts to maximize seats for Democrats. What's changed over time, though, is that sophisticated computer programs make it much more possible to engage in partisan gerrymandering with a precision like never before. Consider North Carolina as an example. It's basically a purple state. It went for Obama in 2008, for Romney in 2012, for Trump in 2016, but always by narrow margins. The Republicans got a bare majority of the votes cast for the state legislature, but then drew state legislative districts to give themselves a supermajority in both houses of the North Carolina legislature in 10 of 13 congressional seats from the state of North Carolina. Of course, this goes on in all states, whether it's Democrats or Republicans in control of the legislature, if there's not an independent districting commission. Gill versus Whitford comes from the state of Wisconsin. It has facts quite similar to that in North Carolina. Republicans got a slight majority of the votes cast overall for the state legislature, but then drew the legislative districts to give themselves a significant majority of the seats in both houses of the state legislature. In November 2016, a three-judge federal district court, in a 2-1 decision, found that the partisan gerrymandering violated the Constitution. The three-judge court said it had a standard for determining when such gerrymandering is unconstitutional, called it the efficiency gap. It said, compare the votes that a party gets for the state legislature with the number of seats it ends up with. If the gap is large and it can't be explained other than by partisanship, it violates equal protection. The court articulated a three-part test, and you know that judges love three-part tests. The Supreme Court granted review. The Supreme Court unanimously reversed and remanded the case. Chief Justice Roberts wrote the opinion for the court. The most important concurring opinion was Justice Kagan's, joined by Justices Ginsburg, Breyer, and Sotomayor. Chief Justice Roberts said that the case had to be dismissed for lack of standing. Now, the court actually didn't dismiss the case, but remanded it. The court said standing requires that there be a personal injury. He said the personal injury has to be alleged and proven. He said the plaintiffs alleged in their complaint they lived in districts which had been affected by the partisan gerrymandering, the packing of people of the same political party into a particular district, or the cracking, splitting up into different districts. But he said they didn't prove at trial that they lived in these districts, and since they hadn't proven a personally suffered injury, there was no standing. The court said usually, as I already alluded to, a case would be dismissed when there wasn't standing, but he said in this instance, this is an unusual claim, justiciability is uncertain, whether or not the courts can adjudicate it is unclear. He said, so we're gonna send it back to the three-judge court to give the plaintiffs the chance to prove their standing. Justices Thomas and Gorsuch wrote a concurring opinion objecting to this, saying the case should just be dismissed. Justice Kagan, as I said, wrote a separate concurring opinion. In it, it was clear she was trying to give a roadmap to the plaintiffs on remand. She said, first, just prove that you live in a district that's been affected by partisan gerrymandering, a district that was the so-called packing or cracking. And she said, that's not going to be hard for you to do. And then she said, second, on remand, emphasize that there's a violation of the First Amendment, its infringement rights of political association. She said, this would give you a clearer basis for standing than vote dilution and a better argument than relying on equal protection. Everyone, liberal and conservatives, observed that it seemed that she was trying to tell the plaintiffs what kind of an argument to make to have the best chance of appealing to Justice Kennedy when the case returned. Of course, Justice Kennedy is no longer present. It seemed clear from the oral argument that Chief Justice Roberts and Justice Alito and Gorsuch did not want the federal courts to get involved in partisan gerrymandering. Justice Thomas, in earlier cases, had also said that he believed that partisan gerrymandering is not justiciable. It's clear that Justices Kagan, as well as Ginsburg, Breyer, and Sotomayor believe that partisan gerrymandering violates the Constitution. So whether there'll be a fifth vote to find that federal courts can challenge the partisan gerrymandering, whether there's a fifth vote to find that partisan gerrymandering violates the Constitution, will very much depend on the new justice. Justice Kagan, in her dissent, talked about how partisan gerrymandering is a threat to the democratic process. She said, "We all learned, maybe in civics, that voters are supposed to choose their elected officials. She said, partisan gerrymandering means that elected officials are choosing their voters." She talked about how partisan gerrymandering has contributed to the polarization in our political system. The issue is going to come back to the Supreme Court, likely sometime soon. The fifth area that I want to talk about concerns federalism, and there are two important cases here. The first is Murphy versus NCAA. Congress passed a federal statute that states needed to have laws that prohibited betting on professional and amateur athletics. There was an exception, though, for four states that already allowed sports betting. Additionally, the law said the state of New Jersey had 1 year to decide whether it wanted to allow sports betting in Atlantic City. New Jersey didn't do anything in that year. Subsequent to that, the New Jersey voters passed an initiative to allow the legislature to pass a law to permit sports gambling. The legislature then adopted such a law. The federal district court in New Jersey found this was preempted by federal law. The federal district court said New Jersey was given a year under the statute, and it didn't exercise that option. The Third Circuit affirmed, the Supreme Court denied review. The New Jersey legislature then tried a different approach. It repealed the existing law that was on the books that prohibited sports gambling. The federal district court said, "No way. You had a year to decide if you wanted to allow sports gambling. You didn't do it. You can't do it this way either." The Third Circuit affirmed. The United States Supreme Court, in a 6-3 decision, reversed. Justice Alito wrote the opinion for the court. Justice Ginsburg wrote the dissent, joined by Justice Sotomayor and Kagan. Justice Alito relied on earlier Supreme Court cases that held that it violates the 10th Amendment for Congress to commandeer state and local governments, to force them to drop laws or enact regulations. In New York versus United States in 1992, the court declared unconstitutional the Federal Low-Level Radioactive Disposal Act, that required that all states clean up their waste by 1996 or begin to take title to them. Justice O'Connor said, "It violates the Constitution for Congress to force states to adopt laws or enact regulations." In Prince versus the United States in 1997, the court declared unconstitutional a provision of the Federal Brady Handgun Control Act that required that state and local law enforcement personnel do background checks for issuing permits for firearms. Justice Scalia wrote for the court saying it was impermissible commandeering. Justice Alito in Murphy versus NCAA said that it's impermissible commandeering for Congress to force states to have laws on the book that prohibit sports gambling. The court said if Congress wants to use its Commerce Clause power to prohibit sports betting, Congress can do so. But Congress can't force states like New Jersey to have such a law. Justice Alito then said the other provisions of the law were not severable. It's not likely that Congress would have adopted them without this core provision, so the entire statute was unconstitutional. Justice Thomas, in a concurring opinion, said the Supreme Court really needs to rethink the whole issue of severability and when an entire law should be struck down because a part is unconstitutional. Justice Breyer, in a concurring opinion, and then Justice Ginsburg in the dissent, said that other provisions of this law should have been regarded as severable and upheld. Why is this case likely to matter? Well, from a practical perspective, we're already seeing a number more states are going to allow sports betting. But I think the larger significance of this might be in litigation that's now pending in a number of circuits, including the Ninth Circuit, that involves a challenge to President Trump's executive order and Attorney General Jeff Sessions' policy that state and local governments should lose the federal law enforcement funds if they don't cooperate with federal immigration officials. Federal district courts in San Francisco, Chicago, and Philadelphia have found that to be impermissible commandeering, undue coercion. this decision may lend support on behalf of the conclusions of the district courts. The other case that I wanted to mention with regard to federalism will have practical effects of a very different sort. It's South Dakota versus Wayfair. A quarter century ago, in Quill versus North Dakota, the Supreme Court held that a state cannot require that an out-of-state business collect sales tax unless the out-of-state business has a physical presence in the state. Well, this has become ever more important, obviously, in the context of internet companies that make sales even though they don't have a physical presence in the state. It's estimated that state governments are losing about $33 billion a year in tax revenue by not being able to force these out-of-state companies to collect sales tax. In South Dakota versus Wayfair, the Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, expressly overruled Quill. Unusual split among the justices. Justice Kennedy wrote the opinion for the court. It was joined by Justices Thomas, Alito, Gorsuch, and Ginsburg. Chief Justice Roberts wrote the dissent, joined by Justice Breyer, Sinner, and Kagan. Now, that's not a split you see every day in the Roberts Court. Justice Kennedy said, Quill was wrong when it was decided, and it's wrong today. And he pointed to the tremendous revenue that states lose by not being able to force out-of-state companies to collect sales tax from businesses that don't have a physical presence in the state. He said that the court should refer to prior decision in Complete Auto Transit versus Brady that articulates when can a state tax out-of-state businesses. And the first prong of that test says that a state can tax out-of-state businesses so long as it has a substantial nexus to the taxing state. And then he gave a definition of substantial nexus. So what's likely to be the practical consequences of this? Well, first, I think we're going to see a lot of litigation over what does substantial nexus mean. A state can't tax any out-of-state company, can't require that any out-of-state company collect sales tax, only those with a substantial nexus. And the definition given by Justice Kennedy is quite ambiguous as to what's going to be enough. Also, this does mean that states are going to be able to collect a lot of money, perhaps as much as $33 billion. And maybe they'll use some of that to give raises to professors and deans at state universities. The sixth and final area that I want to talk about concerns a couple of federal statutes. I think in many ways, one of the sleeper cases of the term is Epic Systems versus Lewis. It's actually three cases that came to the Supreme Court together. One was from the Ninth Circuit, Morris versus Ernst & Young, and there was also the NLRB versus Murphy Oil. The case involves the intersection between two federal statutes. The National Labor Relations Act protects the right of employees to engage in concerted activity for mutual assistance or protection. On the other hand, the Federal Arbitration Act, law adopted a dozen years earlier in 1925, says that arbitration clauses in contracts in interstate commerce shall be enforced unless irrevocable under state law. The issue here is, can an employer require as a condition of employment that an employee submit any disputes to individual arbitration? Is that arbitration clause to be enforced under the Federal Arbitration Act? Or is the right to engage in concerted activity for mutual assistance and protection sufficient to allow the individual to resist such clauses and be able to submit any dispute to a court, including in a class action suit? The Ninth Circuit, an opinion by Chief Judge Thomas, ruled that here the provisions of the National Labor Relations Act should control. The Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, came to the opposite conclusion. Justice Gorsuch wrote for the court, joined by Chief Justice Roberts, as well as Justice Thomas and Alito. Justice Ginsburg wrote the dissent, here joined obviously by Justice Breyer, Sinner, and Kagan. Justice Gorsuch here said that the Federal Arbitration Act is clear, that arbitration clauses in interstate commerce shall be enforced. He said that the ability to engage in concerted activity for mutual protection or aid is really about the ability to do that for purpose of union organizing. It doesn't apply with regard to the resolution of disputes. And that in itself, this narrowing in the construction of this provision of the National Labor Relations Act could have very significant implications for the future. He said he was relying on the plain language of the statutes and that the legislative history wasn't relevant. So the court held that an employer is a condition of employment can require that an employee submit any dispute to individual arbitration, giving up the ability to file class action suits. Justice Ginsburg wrote a vehement dissent here. She talked about what this is going to mean in issues like wage theft or discrimination or harassment, where often what the individual employee loses is too little to justify an action, even arbitration. She said the only way to provide remedies when a large number of people lose a small amount of money is class action. She said that the majority was abandoning the interpretation of the National Labor Relations Act that the National Labor Relations Commission had followed for 75 years. So the case is going to be significant in the employment context in terms of these kinds of disputes, but I think also significant with regard to the court's interpretation of the National Labor Relations Act. Final case is Jesner versus Arab Bank. It involves a federal statute adopted in 1789, the Alien Tort Statute. It gives to federal courts jurisdiction to hear torts in violation of the law of nations. This was, for a few decades, the primary vehicle for litigating international human rights cases in federal courts. But over the last decade, the Supreme Court has continually narrowed the availability of the Alien Tort Statute. In Sosa versus Alvarez Machain, the Supreme Court said, the Alien Tort Statute just creates jurisdiction. It doesn't create a cause of action. In Kiobel versus Royal Dutch Petroleum, the Supreme Court said that a foreign corporation could not be sued for its activities outside the United States affecting foreign nationals. In Jesner versus Arab Bank, the Supreme Court went even further and said that foreign corporations cannot be sued under the Alien Tort Statute. It was 5-4, with Justice Kennedy writing for the conservative justices. Justice Kennedy said that courts should be very reluctant about creating causes of action. So there's a need to interpret the Alien Tort Statute in a restrictive way because inevitably it affects foreign policy. This was a case against a bank in Jordan for allegedly financing terrorist activities. He said the court should not get involved in such matters. And so the court articulates a bright line rule that foreign corporations cannot be sued under the Alien Tort Statute. If you put together Sosa versus Alvarez Machain, Kiobel versus Royal Dutch Petroleum, and now Jesner, you see, the court very much narrowing, realistically, leaving very little in terms of litigation that can be brought under the ATS. So if you put all of this together, you can see why I began by saying it's such an amazing time in the United States Supreme Court. And Judge Bybee and I said we'd save a little less than 10 minutes for questions.
Thank you. That was wonderful. And we do have time for questions. Is there anyone who would like to pose a question? Come on, somebody. Oh, okay. Yes.
So there was a comment early on in the job that Justice Kennedy did not tone liberal Democratic policy in his term. Do you have any insight on whether that had anything to do with his decision or if it is a shift in his own jurisprudence in any way, or for perhaps the liberal justices being trying to be to more liberal rules, or is there any color observations you have around why that was the same as term?
I'll give you a quick answer. No, I don't know of any connection that anybody's been able to draw any connection between Justice Kennedy's vote in the 5-4 cases and his impending retirement. It would be an interesting connection to draw, but nobody's. I don't know of anybody who's done it. Now maybe Erwin does.
Unless Justice Kennedy wants to tell us, we'll never know the answer to that question. Justice Kennedy has been a fairly conservative justice over time. There's certain areas where he's always been with the conservatives, like the campaign finance cases, like the Second Amendment cases, like the Establishment Clause cases. And then there's been areas where Justice Kennedy has been consistently with the liberals, the gay and lesbian rights cases, certain limits on the death penalty, and we can track those. None of his decisions this term would be inconsistent with his prior rulings, except for Masterpiece Cake Shop versus Colorado Civil Rights Commission. That, as I said in passing, every Supreme Court decision expanding rights for gays and lesbians in all of American history had the majority opinion written by Anthony Kennedy. Roe versus Evans in 1996, Lawrence versus Texas in 2003, United States versus Windsor in 2013, Obergefell versus Hodges in 2015. Here, though, Justice Kennedy did not come down on the side of the gay couple. Also, I would point you to, and I didn't talk about it, Justice Kennedy wrote an unusual concurring opinion in Trump versus Hawaii, in which he said, there's some things that are unconstitutional that courts can't stop, but it's very important that government officials comply with the Constitution. And many people, when they read that opinion, immediately inferred that he's about to retire, which obviously happened the next day.
Question? Somebody? Come on. We have great panelists here. Let's see, we got 5 minutes. Yes.
You mentioned the gerrymandering issue in California. It does have independent districting board, and I wondered if you could comment, I suppose, but outside of maybe the scope of this, of how you think that's functioning and how it compares to other states.
Sure. In 2015, in Arizona State Legislature versus Arizona Redistricting Commission, the Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, held that states can have independent district commissions, including when it comes to House of Representatives districts. Justice Ginsburg wrote the opinion for the court, and it sharply condemned the practice of partisan gerrymandering. Her opinion was joined by Justice Breyer, Senator Kagan, and Kennedy. And it was Justice Kennedy's joining Justice Ginsburg's opinion in that case that led many to believe that he might be willing to be a fifth vote to find partisan gerrymandering to be unconstitutional. Now, the court obviously didn't do that in the context of Gill versus Whitford because the case was decided on standing grounds. Slightly less than 20 of the states have independent districting commissions, which means slightly more than 30 of the states still can and do engage in partisan gerrymandering. One thing that I would mention, and it may have much larger significance than just this issue, earlier this spring, the Pennsylvania Supreme Court found that the partisan gerrymandering of the Pennsylvania legislature and its congressional districts violated the Pennsylvania Constitution. The United States Supreme Court denied review because it's based on independent and adequate state grounds. This might then be a model for litigation that we'll see in the future, where you might see more challenges to partisan gerrymandering in states that don't have independent district commissions based on state constitutional law.
Just one comment I want to add to that one of the issues in the Arizona case from a couple of years ago was whether the Constitution required the Arizona legislature to approve this or not. What Arizona had done was turn it over to an independent commission and then allow their decision to be final without some other kind of approval by the legislature. That's probably an easy fix even for those who dissented in that case. In other words, there's probably an easy way of having an independent commission do something and then have a bit of a rubber stamp come from the legislature so that it has that imprimatur. We faced this question a long time ago in what was known as the base realignment cases, where we were trying to figure out how to close military bases. And it was so controversial that what Congress did was establish a commission, say, you figure out which bases have to be closed, and we're simply going to rubber stamp it because it had to be a congressional action. So there are ways of doing this if we really want to get to an independent electioning commission. These are very, very naughty problems. That's naughty with a K. These are very, very difficult. These are very, very difficult questions that the court was about to take up in Gill.
All right, and that does, I think. Sure.
This is for the dean. Dean, in your capacity now as dean of a major law school, you get to make higher than your decisions. And I understand you hired recently, I won't say coach, but that you hired someone from the FJC, and I wonder if you want to talk about that later this afternoon, so this is a preview of our conversations with Judge Fogel. But what do you intend to do with Judge Fogel?
I am thrilled that we're creating the Berkeley Judicial Institute. It will focus especially on issues with regard to judicial independence and judicial integrity. I am thrilled that Judge Fogel is going to be our first director. We could not possibly have a better person in the country or the world to lead the Berkeley Judicial Institute than Jeremy Fogel. And I think sometime around mid-September, he'll be leaving the bench and leaving the FJC to head up the Berkeley Judicial Institute. And I hope that we'll be able to do programs that will benefit everyone in this room. So thank you so much for that question.
Please thank again our speakers for their time and their insights. Gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Cathy. Thank you, Judge Bencivengo. We appreciate that. And Dean and Judge Bybee, thanks so much. This is a great way to start the conference with this conversation. And someone mentioned to me this morning that Judge Bybee is the only person that can make statistics fun and interesting. And he once again did that. And Dean, thank you so much for your assistance here. We'll take a break. Please be back at 11 o'clock. Yes, give a round of applause, please. Thank you.